morning.
All right. Welcome to church, everybody. I am blessed that you guys could be here this morning. Hopefully, you guys made it safe and sound with all that snow out there. And hopefully, you guys are nice and warm in here. There's lots of, well, I don't know if there's lots anymore. I've been out there eating them. But yummies and goodies and coffee and all that stuff out there. So blessed that you guys could be here, and it's just excited that we could come together and worship this morning. A few announcements before we get going. Tonight we'll have youth group upstairs like always. We're going to have some spaghetti tonight, and looking forward to that. We've just been challenging myself and just the young people in the church just truly to pursue what God has for them in that good and perfect will that he has for us. So excited about that as that continues to go. Next Sunday will be the start of the Holy Spirit class. So that's really, really exciting. If you have a desire to learn and grow in just the Holy Spirit, love to have you guys come out and just take part of that. So that's really an awesome thing that is really, really good. Lots of Bible studies starting up. J.D. Moore's Bible study for men on Monday night continue to go at 7 p.m. And all I hear is good stuff. So if you're a man that has a desire to just meet with other men, to be challenged to be your best, go on out to that. That'll be really, really good. Women have some things coming up on the January 18th at 6:30 Women's Bible Study. And if you have a desire to be part of that, ladies, see Deb Snyder. She is excited about just getting that going and just connecting with you guys and ladies just connecting with one another. And so that's really, really good. As well as the women's small groups will start up. Have they started yet? Somebody, they have. Okay, so they started yet. They have started, but they are going on Thursday nights at 6 p.m. And there's four different locations, St. Paris, Rosewood, Westville, and Urbana. And another opportunity, no matter where you live, to try to get involved with the different ladies in the church, or if you're not in the church. So it's good. Excited about all that. Just things continue to come and continue to happen that we're excited about. This Saturday at 2 p.m., the youth are going to go tubing at Mad River Mountain, as long as it's not 50 degrees. But if today's any indication, I think winter's maybe here finally. But the cost for tubing is $25, and we'll get to go and just go tubing for 3 hours, get some food. It's usually pretty fun. And so if your students want to be part of that, we're doing that this Saturday at 2 p.m. Looking forward to that and just excited about everything going on. Have so many opportunities to love on God. And that's all of us together. Last night I got an opportunity to take a group of kids to students to Winter Jam. Was really excited about it. But if you've ever been to Winter Jam, you know it's really, really fun. If you've never seen flames fly up from the stage, and just when you feel the warmth from it, it's like, whoa, that's pretty cool. And so, but it's really exciting, a lot of fun. But there's also kind of a worry sometimes that you may not get seats, because I've been turned away for not being enough room. And so trying to take a group of 20 plus young people over there to try to get seats is a little bit like, oh Lord, I need your help, because I don't want to be that person that gets turned around or gets stuck up in the nosebleeds at the very top. And so I tell you all that because we plan and we try to put our plans in motion, but I remember coming to place, I'm like, Lord, I just want this to be fun. I want this to be just something we can enjoy. And it happens that Doty and Chuck Patton went down early, and Doty was blessed by these people that had extra passes to let you in early. So she was able to go in and corral 24 seats for us to sit really, really, really close. And so just to tell you that, because God is loving, He's faithful. And even if we didn't get those seats, we still would have had a good time. But we just were really blessed last night. And so I'm just so grateful for that this morning. I just tell you guys, I have to encourage you and just let you know what's going on. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you so much, Lord, for who you are, God. Lord, as the snow's here, as the seasons are changing, and just, Lord, I thank you for this building and for heat. Lord, I thank you for a place and opportunity that we can come together, Lord, and just have a desire to worship you and love you, God. So, Lord, I pray that that's what we do this morning, God. I pray, Lord, that we just give you our hearts, Lord, that we give you our mind, Lord. We give you our words, God, and everything that we do, Lord. So I pray that you bless this offering, that your will be done, Lord. And, God, just in the good and the bad, the big and the little in our life, God, I pray that we give everything to you. through the situations that we go through that are hard and tough, Lord, that we need help, God. I pray that you bless us, Lord. But I pray that we just hand those things to you, Lord, that we seek you instead of turning other places, God. So I pray that you bless us this morning, Lord. I pray that you bless the word. Lord, I pray that during this time of worship, God, that we can just love on you, Lord, God, and just, Lord, just be thankful for who you are and what you do and what you've done. So we love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We have a mighty King, King of glory. Amen. Father God, we worship you today. We want to lift you up.
Lift up your gaze, be lifted up. Tell everyone how great the love. The love come down from heaven's gate to kiss the earth with hope and grace. Singing, who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. Who is this King of glory?
You're the King of glory. We praise you today, Father. Lift you up. Hallelujah. Our God is greater than anything we can face in this world. Amen. Lord, you love us, and we thank you for that. Lord, we praise you today.
Wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one. Then what can stand against?
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us?
And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? What can stand against?
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher.
Then what can stand against?
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us?
And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? What can stand against?
What can stand against?
What can stand
for that, God. We praise you. Lord, we surrender our lives to you. Lord, we give you our lives, Father. Place you first in our life, Father.
I want to know.
Into this place, Lord, like a rushing wind. Amen.
Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe in. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm.
First line of this song, because I know that you're alive. Our Lord Jesus is alive, amen. And he came to fix our lives. I know my life has been broken, and the Lord has put the pieces together in my life, and I'm so thankful for that. Lord, I praise you. I praise you daily. Today, let him hear your voice. That's what he wants. He wants to speak through you. Use your voice to praise him today. Lord, we love you. We love you.
Fire, fall down. Fire.
come with thankful hearts today. Thankful for your Son who sacrificed everything for us. Lord, we praise you. Hallelujah. Father God, we love you. We love you today, and we give you our lives. We surrender to you today. Lord, be with us, Lord. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bengals started acting like the Steelers last night. And I know you're alive. And broken life. And I'll sing. Some of those folks got their Steelers shirts on today. And I wasn't too happy about how our Bengals acted, though. You know what I mean? I'm pretty embarrassed by behavior of them guys. All right, Bengals depression sets in. Bengal depression. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you. Thanks for coming. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming through the snow. That snow came right there at church time, early church there. When Jim Morris got up this morning to milk the cows at whatever time. When's milking time now? 3:30. It was 46 degrees. At 6:50, when I left the house this morning, it was 39 degrees, raining. I think it's 30 degrees now or something out there. And anyhow, and it's going down, and winter's coming, getting us. And Dave Miller's having surgery. Is it tomorrow? Tomorrow, Dave, right? What? Tuesday. I'm getting my Mondays and Tuesdays mixed up here. Mondays and Tuesdays mixed up. So where's she at? Right there, having surgery tomorrow. Tomorrow, she's having major neck surgery in the morning. Yeah. Lee Bowser's having surgery. Is that tomorrow morning? Yeah. So some people having some serious surgery here in the next few days. Just pray for folks. Would you do that? Be thankful about that. Wow. So we get to teach and preach today, and excited for that, okay? Good stuff. Jamie went over to be grandma yesterday. I just like to tell you little stories. My little grandson was down in Springfield, and we don't see him all that much, so it's not like me, but I thought, I'm going to sneak down here and see my little grandson. And got to the door there and came in. He come running to me, man, that little guy. You know, his DNA and my DNA is like one number different. I mean, we're just... It's the truth. We're like, anyhow, he comes running to me saying, I love Granny. She'd been blackmailing him or probably holding a gun to him or something the whole time and trying to get him to say that. He wasn't going to say that unless she like threatened him or something. But you know who he came running to, don't you? Anyhow, that little guy is something else. And excited about all that. I guess some folks went yesterday to that Winter Jam concert, and Crowder looked like a freak, man. David Crowder, Duck Dynasty look. Yeah. Did you go last night, Connie?
I did.
You took your kids and went? Yeah. So that's good. Somebody said King and Country at the end were really good. And do you know that's Rebecca St. James' brothers? Did you know that? Rebecca St. James from some years ago. Her brothers played music for her all those years and traveled with her. And she got married and started having kids and got off the road. And her brothers formed King and Country. And that's, And they're Australian. That's all Rebecca St. James. So that's all good. That's all good. And some rappers. Were there some rappers there? You want me to bust you out a rap? I don't have enough throat to do that whole thing. So, hey, thanks for coming to church. I'm just trying to mess around, goof around for a minute here and small talk with you. So, Lord, would you come this morning and help us? Get me out of small talk mode, Lord, and into what I'm supposed to do today. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for a time just to sing. Thank you for those who come out on a snowy day. Lord, just meet us here in this place. That's my heart. Get a few minutes here to talk to folks that I love. I really do. About your word and, God, how you've kind of presented it to me over the years and the understanding that I have. Mixed with the Holy Spirit, Lord, I pray just powerful things come out of this day. So, Lord, would you just visit us here, speak to us, Lord, in ways we need understanding. In this winter day, Lord, just visit this place. Visit this church here on the side of a hill. Minister to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to start in Romans chapter 11 this morning. Pretty neat verse, I think. Really a neat verse. Love that verse, in fact. And says, what does it say? The gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. Isn't that what it says? For the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. Isn't that pretty neat? Now that makes us think a whole bunch, doesn't it? That God gives us gifts and He has a calling in our life. There's verses there about God called us. God called us out of the world. God called us to serve Him. And I don't know how you picture it for you, but Lord saved me from something bad to do something for Him. Before I ever thought about pastoring a church, and there was a lot of years I served the Lord before I ever thought about pastoring a church, I just tried to let God use me. You know, I worked a secular job a lot of years, and I think, though at 18 years old, the Lord kind of spoke to me, He's going to use me the rest of my life. I had an engineering office, and I had a lot of people that reported to me, and they knew I was a Christian enough, they'd come in the office and shut the door and ask me to pray for them. So I was trying to be a light in a workplace a lot of years. And there was a lot of years people made fun of you for this and that and the other. But when they had a serious need, they'd come along and, you know what I mean? And I always knew God was stirring something in me from a young man. I knew God had given me certain giftings. That makes sense? And those things that God gives, He gives and He doesn't take them away. That's what this verse is saying. That God gives gifts and He calls us and that doesn't ever change. So for your entire life, you've been given something from God to use for God. He's not going to mess with that. He's going to try to work with you on it to get you better at it. But He really, really wants you to do well at the things He put in you to use for Him, really, right? We have this saying, and it kind of hits people off. You know, the one verse says, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. So from that verse you take, oh, Lord, this is your day. You made this day. This day wasn't about me. This day, Sunday, what is it? The 10th of January, 2016. Can you believe that? Is a day God made. You get that? God made this day. You're living in His day, right? And I believe that God created us, and within us, He put something in us. So, Lord, You created me, special and unique for You, right? And You gave me these gifts and these callings. You're trying to call me to something. You're trying to use me in something. And God, what You're saying in this verse is, You give me this stuff and You don't take it away. You're not messing with me. God isn't an Indian giver. You get that whole thing? And I don't know if anybody has ever, I don't know how to say this, ever been real deep in the Lord and then kind of slid back some to realize that when they go back to the Lord just kind of brings you back. You never lost anything. You get that whole thing? How God loves us. And God isn't a taker of things from men. God's a giver. Father God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten. So Father God loves and gives. That's in this period of grace that we're in, that's what Father God does. He loves and he gives. And God isn't trying. I know the one verse says he gives and takes away. But that's in the context, not in spirit, in terms of giftings or callings. It's in terms of things in life only to make us better. You know what I mean? So this verse says, related to you, there's some kind of gift that God gave you, and there's some kind of calling he wants you to walk in, and he's not going to take that. Your entire life, you're going to have that. People say to me, you know, when I was a young man, I felt like God called me to preach. And I always look at them and say, then preach. Because it didn't matter if you thought he called you as young, that calling's in your life for the rest of your life. You know, I felt like I was supposed to sing, but years went by and I put on some weight. I don't want to stand in front of people to sing. Hey, putting on weight don't stop me. It shouldn't stop you. I'm kidding you. I'm supposed to be funny. Sing! You know, you can make excuses for why you're not walking in what God wants you to walk in, but God gave you those gifts for life, and sometimes you feel like, man, I missed an opportunity. Well, you have that for life. You get that whole thing? And that's what this verse says. So I'm going to jump along here to talk about these giftings that we get. In fact, here's a, can you see past the podium? Here's gifts from God, and there's three separate lists in the Scripture, gifts from God. There's gifts from the Father, 7 motivational gifts. We're going to talk about those in just a minute. Gifts from the Father. 5 gifts from Jesus the Son, a list of those gifts. And then 9 spiritual gifts that we get from the Holy Spirit. Those lists are in the Scripture, okay? And there's no reason why you don't have understanding of that, and you don't have those things operating in your lives. Everybody kind of get that thing? If you want to go someplace with the Lord, then begin to walk in these giftings that God makes available to you. Right? I'll talk about this first one first here, the gifts from the Father. I believe these, what we call motivational gifts, there's 7 different types of gifts. You got them from birth. They're the things that motivate you. They're the things that cause you to be driven. They're the things that, and they're also the things that make us personality-wise very different. Make sense? I married a lady that's very different than me. Not because she's just a woman, but because she has a different motivational gift than I do. That makes sense? And as we got married, the thing that started to happen was I saw something really beautiful in her, but it was so very different. And once we got married, then we started fighting over the differences we had. You get that whole thing? And what really, really helped us in marriage was I began to understand who God created her to be, who God created me to be, and how those things conflict because we look at the world very different. Make sense? So if you can have some understanding of these motivational gifts, you can understand, oh, that person's this gifting, so that's why we have these differences. Make sense? I always, before I marry people, give them these motivational gift tests so they understand who it is they're married to, and because you're given this stuff from birth, you're never going to change it. I'm never going to make my wife somebody different than who God made her from the beginning, at her core. That gift is with her. That calling is with her. It's irrevocable. I'm not going to change her. I'm a big believer in let people be who they want to be because God made them different. Right? I love that we don't try to dress the same around here. I love that we're not trying to model, you know, like... I'm perfectly happy that people are who they are, and I want people to be who they want to be. Right? But I want you to also have understanding that there's 7 different types of people. Psychology is saying now there's 7 different types of people. Romans chapter 12. I think we'll start about verse 4. As we have many members in the body, but all the members do not have the same function. Talking about the body, we're talking about, but in this case, we're talking about the church. Often, Paul at least here uses an illustration of the physical body to describe how the church should fit together. Everybody get that? People can say, I don't have to go to church to be a Christian. By fact, you can ask the Lord to forgive you, but if I'm supposed to be the finger in the body of Christ and I get that thing cut off away from the body, it doesn't live very long or have much of a life or much of a function outside of the rest of the body. Does everybody get that? The Lord Jesus died for us, paid His great price for our sin, but then put us in a body of believers, yoked us together so that we might be in a place where all of our giftings together represent who Jesus was, you know, in a body, in a place where we gather together. Jesus is present here, not just because He's with us, but because every one of you have a gifting that comes from God that was in Jesus, and us together represent Jesus better than any other thing on earth. The church does. You get that? And I love people that come in our church that are very different. You get that whole thing? Man, we got people. I think in a lot of churches, the pastor thinks he's the smartest guy in the church and all that. I know I'm not the smartest guy in the church. I don't even pretend to try to be the smartest guy in the church. I'm not the most talented musically in the church. I'm not the best singer there is. I'm close, but not. I'm not the best looking guy in the church. I'm just a guy in the church. Part of the body of Christ. You're a person in the body of Christ. The verses before this says, don't think of yourself too big. Don't think of yourself too little. The verses before that says, let your minds be transformed. Let your minds be renewed to understand these things. But don't be too big or be too little. Be a member in the body of Christ. Be a valuable participant in the body of Christ. You get that whole thing? You were here because God called you here to add something here. You're supposed to take something away like a body part does. You get something from the body, but you're also supposed to give something to the body. I always tell this kind of gross illustration. But a couple years ago, I had what did I lose? Gallbladder, that's what I lost. See, I lost it so long ago, I forgot about it. A couple years ago, I lost my gallbladder. I wasn't like walking down the road and it fell out. It started acting up. We got a big old gallstone, and the doctor said, let's get that thing out of there. I said, please get that thing out of there, because if you've ever had big gallstone things, it's like you're getting stabbed with a knife, if you ever had that or not. But I said, please get that thing out of there. So we get that thing out of there. And now, years later, I go, I'd like to have that back. Your gallbladder adds a little enzyme to your digestive system. You all know that? This is health class or something, you know? And that little enzyme helps you digest, especially grease, a little bit better. I love grease. Right? Love grease. When I don't have this gallbladder, guess what? I eat something that's a little bit greasy. Guess what happens? It doesn't digest very well. Guess what? You know what grease does when it goes sliding through you? You didn't catch it. So you eat something greasy, it goes right through, phew, right? You can almost recognize it. I shouldn't have said that right there. Anyhow, sorry about that. I'm sorry. Some of you laughed. Some of you said, I'm never coming back. I'm sorry about that. To those that said, you're never coming back, please forgive me. I didn't even know I needed a gallbladder. I didn't even know I had this such a thing. You know what I mean? It was in me before I ever knew it was there, before I ever knew it had a problem, you know? It was doing its job quietly, doing its job quietly, doing its job quietly. I had it took out. I thought, no big deal. I don't need it. I'd love to have it back. And you know, in the body of Christ, there's visible members. There's visible parts of the body. There's parts that make noise, there's parts that are seen, there's parts that are not seen, there's parts, but all that's supposed to be in the body of Christ to make it function and be what it's supposed to be. You can be a very quiet member in the body of Christ and be very, very important in the body of Christ. I've received anonymous cards from people, and they have no idea when I open those cards. The moment I open those cards, what that thing speaks to me. You hear me? You can be absolutely amazing member in the body of Christ and not be seen or heard, or people don't even know your name. Does that make sense? But welcome to something the Lord's trying to do. Welcome to a group, a gathering of people, a fellowship of people where God's trying to do something that really represents Jesus. By everybody participating in the gifting they have and bringing it together, you ought to be your very best in church because God gifted you with a gift that's really supposed to be useful in the body of Christ. Now, we take those same gifts and we use them outside for other things, and we normally are very successful or very fulfilled when we use those gifts wherever we use them at, but they're primarily given to us so we can minister to our brothers and sisters in church. Everybody get that? Next verse. For we, being many members, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. So we're connected, right? Are we not connected? You? Are we not connected? Would you, if you saw me out, would you not speak to me? Would you not invite me over? Isn't there something kind of special that we have a connection that we have, and there's just something warm about that, you know, something good about that? You can count on me, and I probably can count on you. Does that make sense? Do you all get that? Just this morning, as I'm talking to people, people say to me, do you need this? Do you need that? Why would you ever give something to me? And I'm saying to people, hey, I can get that to you, and we'll try to get over there this week, and we'll try to do, you know what I mean? Why? Because there's just a connection, and we're trying to help one another and give to one another and bless one another and be what the other one needs, and you need this, and no, but I know somebody who needs that. And right? There's a connection between us. We play a game sometimes in the summertime. I love to play that game. I'll take a piece of red thread, and I'll tell you to run it through an article of your clothing and pass it to the person beside you, and a whole section will run that piece of red thread. And it's just a perfect representation of how we're bound together by something common. It's really the Lord. I love what I see go on in our church. I love how people laugh with each other and talk with each other. People have said to me before, this is a pretty disrespectful church. You know, a lot of people come from the denominational churches, and they come in here, and this is the loudest church, by the way, a lot of people ever come to. You come in here, and people are talking and running around and moving, and you know, people say they're awful. They're not quiet and reserved there at the church, and you get up to speak, and sometimes you got to wait a while for them to get quiet, and why don't you tell them to be quiet and be more reverent in church? And I always say, no, I love that about our church. I'll wait a few minutes for people to have a little conversation with somebody and love on each other. And you get with all that? Individually, members of one another. Next verse. Having then gifts differing according to the graces given to us, let us use them. Having gifts differing according to the grace, meaning the Lord's goodness, the Lord's giving, given to us, given, let's use them. What are you supposed to do with your gifts? Use them. Tyler plays pretty good drum set, doesn't he? Doesn't he play pretty good drums? Doesn't he? Aren't you so glad he comes and does that for us? Aren't you? Tyler, they're not all that grateful at all. Are you guys grateful that he plays drums for us? That's a little better, right? Man, we love your drum playing. We love it. Do, 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 do. You're alive. We love that, right? We'd be in trouble this morning without a drummer. Wouldn't we have been in trouble without a drummer? Or a piano player, or somebody standing at the door to greet you, or somebody made those cookies this morning, or somebody's teaching your kids right now. You want me to keep going? Somebody sitting beside you that really loves you. Somebody shook your hands and genuinely said, hey, good to see you this morning. Somebody helped you in a parking lot. Somebody gave you a smile today. You know what I mean? If you got a gift, use it. Right? Use it. Use it. God gave it to you. Use it. You'll never wear it out. It'll never run out. That makes sense? It's a gift given by God. It has plenty of energy and plenty of usefulness. And just give it, give it, give it, give it, give it, give it, give it. First one here, if prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Now we're talking about these seven ministry gifts that we get from birth, from the Father. Everybody get that? The first one here is also the hardest one to describe. But there are people in one of those seven different giftings that have a gift of prophecy. And this isn't, thus says the Lord. This is a motivational gift where you just know what's wrong and right. You have the ability to speak very boldly, sometimes very harshly. You're not afraid. You have a personality that's kind of a bulldozer. You know what I mean? You can just say it. You ever met people that are very, very bold, that very much will just speak what's on, they're not worried about people's feelings. They just speak what, that's the truth. They have these people with this kind of gifting have the ability to know what's wrong and right. They're able to discern good from evil. They know what's fake and phony. And they don't have a lot of words, but the words they often use are pretty direct. They, again, are not worried about people's feelings. They just know they're supposed to speak what they know is true. God uses these people to bring correction in the body of Christ, to straighten things up, to cause things to really save a lot of time. The rest of the ministry gifts are not as direct, so they end up working with people over time. This prophetic gift is just pretty pointed and direct. Straighten up. If you ever met anybody in the body of Christ, they're just not, they seem to be that friendly. They talk very little. When they talk, they come across sometimes kind of harsh. These folks don't always have a lot of friends because people don't always know how to take them. Sometimes they drift out of church because they're not able to build a lot of friends. They know what's wrong and right, and they feel like they have a connection with God, but they don't have a, they're just, because of their personality type, they're not really good at connecting with others. But God can use them very boldly and very directly to speak into things. Often what I tell people with prophecy gift is, hey, use your gift in the body of Christ. Just dull the edge of the knife a little bit. Does that make sense? Because often your gifting is to speak strong and harsh. Just speak with a little bit of love and people will receive it better than you just slashing them. I can tell you, the treasurer we used to have, Tim Reisinger, was a prophetic person. I don't know if you know him very well. I know him very well. He'd just say it was always mine. Sometimes it hurt my feelings. You know what I mean? And I just realized what he's doing, just trying to speak the truth to me. I didn't have to agree with him. You know, it didn't make him God's supernatural person. This was a gift he had. But often he would just try to save time and trying to just get to the point. You know what? Tim didn't have a whole lot of friends. Tim would often say to me, I don't even like people. You know? I'm not into this people. He was a treasurer here. I do a job here. I'm not into the people side of this thing. No, Tim, you're into the people side of this thing because you're... But he would often, he had a close group of friends, you know what I mean? Didn't expand, I'm not picking on him, I was just a person I can tell you that I know had that gifting. Do you feel like you have that gifting, Amanda? Mandy, do you feel like you have that gifting? Yeah. Sometimes I think I see you as that. I'm not trying to pick on you. But what God gives us is good. It's for a purpose. That makes sense? And God uses all seven different kinds of people for good things. There's no better than or less than gift here. It's just how people were created to be. And if you know that, then you know, hey, these people really mean good. They're just a little bit bold. Right? The next gifting of those seven gifts, we read it over here, next verse, is ministry. We see ministry. Let us use it. In ministering. A better word in English, modern English, is serving. If you're a serving people, you like to serve. I have a son that's a server. He likes to do things for people. He likes a specific job to do, a list of things to do. He likes to go in and knock it out, get in, get out. That makes sense? The one thing I know about serving people is they like to be appreciated, like for somebody to say thank you, or I appreciate that, or I like that, you know? And often they get their feelings hurt if people don't do that. You hear me? If you're a person who serves, serve. You like short-term goals? You like to do something in a day or a couple of hours? You go in, do it, kill it, get out of there, right? You feel really good about that. You feel like you've helped. And God uses people in those serving gifts. And if you're a server, guess what you're supposed to do? Serve. Help people. That makes sense? I think my dad was a serving person. My dad loved, he was this guy, if somebody had a flat tire beside the road, he'd love to get out, change your tire, he wouldn't take money for it, and just go on down the road, you know what I mean? He would love, though, they'd say, oh, thank you. My dad was a serving person. He loved to do things for people. He loved for them to appreciate him. That makes sense? And if you're a serving person, then serve in the body of Christ. You with me on that? The next one, he who teaches in teaching. Let me just help you with, if you have a gift of teaching. If you have a gift of teaching, you like to study. A lot of people going, ugh. You spend hours trying to break things down. You make notes, you know what I mean? A lot of times, teachers are people who make these big set of notes. They're people who like to write in journals and like to... They think in very systematic ways. They're trying. They want to break things down to show people step by step. If you're a person who likes to study, then the Lord probably wants you to teach. You get that whole thing? So teach. Where do you start teaching at? Around here, you start teaching with kids. Everybody get that? It'll be okay. Lord will recognize that gift. He'll hone it a little bit. And God will make a place for you in the body of Christ, and you'll be great at that. I think there's some Beth Moore out there is this incredible female teacher, right? The next gift here, in terms of these things you're born with, one who exhorts in exhortation. I am an exhorter. Let me just do it this way. Who in the church, you can't hide exhorters. They got big, loud mouths. Everybody knows them. They're really positive, joyful. Who are exhorters in the church? You know people that are really... Tracy Faulkner. Joy. Deb Snyder. Dodie. They're kind of like little Christian cheerleaders, you know what I mean? Go, 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 fight, win. You know what I mean? What's my motivational gift? My motivational gift is to cheer you on. You know what I mean? Encourage you. Listen, you can do it. God's good. God loves you. He'll never stop loving you. He's in your everyday life. He's in your very mind. He knows what you're thinking. Listen, God, He'll never leave you nor forsake you. Trust the Lord. Learn how to trust the Lord. Learn how to do that. You know, that's... You get me in all that? Big old cheerleaders kind of lift you in the body, lift you up in your Christian walk. You know, kind of... Pep rally, church pep rally, you know? I want you to be excited about serving the Lord. You're on the winning team, you know what I mean? Your Lord is good. His mercy endures forever, right? Be of good courage. And on and on. If the Lord's for you, it could be against you. I just go on and on with the terms we use all the time. Hey, everything works out for good. Bible's just set up for us encouragers to just put it all over you, right? And if you're an encourager, what do? You encourage. Put yourself in a position to encourage. Right? Now, if you got these gifts and you hide them under a bushel, that's what the old King James says, you got a gift, you hide it under, what good is the gift? What good's a gift if you don't use it? Do you still have Christmas presents sitting under the tree that you haven't unwrapped? Because that's what it's like if you have a gift and you don't open it. If you don't use it, it's just sitting around of no value. But if you begin to use it for value, it'll have great value because God gave it to you. Everybody get that whole thing? It's pretty important you figure out what your motivational gift is because you were born with it. It's been running around with you all your entire life. I run into people all the time, they're 50, 60 years old, and go, oh, well, that makes sense. I didn't know that about me. man in the first service said, he got up here and he testified. He talked about a year ago. He had a life or death surgery where they stretched his intestine, took his stomach out and his esophagus, stretched his stomach, his intestine up to form a stomach and an esophagus. And he testified in the first service about the Lord just being with him. And he talked about the value of a day, the value of a second chance, and how he didn't want to squander that. And what he wanted to say, what he said in that was, I still don't know what I'm here for. I thought, when he said that in the first service, I thought, man, I'm glad I'm teaching this. If you don't know what you're here for, if you don't know how God created, if you don't know that you have one of these seven giftings very strongly in your life. See, God gives. Our big struggle on this side of heaven is to figure out what is to press into God enough to understand what he's doing with us. Your job is to chase the Lord to figure out what he has for you, right? Often, I don't know how to say this to you. The Lord has an obligation to reveal himself to you. You all understand that? Because when you're a sinner, you don't know that that's the answer. So God, through circumstances in your life, because he's good, at some point he'll give you some kind of understanding that he is there and that he does love, some understanding that he is God. That makes sense? So God reveals himself to you. But once God's revealed himself to you, he doesn't have any obligation to push you or to drag you or to take you anywhere. He shows you who he is. And the more you understand how great God is, the more you want to understand, hey, I want more of you. And in finding out more of him, what you start to figure out is there's a whole bunch of God already in you. That makes sense? You were created in the likeness and in the image of God. I'm losing people all over the place. They're walking around going to the bathroom here, yawning, all kinds of stuff. You were created in the image of God. That's pretty exciting to me. God created me to be a Christian, a cheerleader. Puts me on a stage. I get an opportunity to use my gift. Did I figure it out real quick? No, in fact, I fought against it. I was scared to death of it. Many of you don't want to know because you don't want to know, right? The more you know, the more you're accountable for. You know, it's kind of like, hey, if I don't have to figure that out, then I don't ever, oh, I'll just stay ignorant. I'll just stay silly. I'll just stay not knowing. I want to be very useful to God in my life. When this is all over, it's all been about God. It hasn't been about how much money you make or how successful you are in the world or how many children you had or what. You know, it's really about, did I operate with what God gave me to the fullest? Did I do, at some point, am I accountable for with what God gave me to him? I'll be ultimately accountable to him for that. Right? I gave you five gifts. What did you do with them? I gave you three gifts. What did you do with them? I gave you a gift. What did you do with it? Well, Lord, I buried it in the earth. What does he say to that guy? Depart from me, you wicked, slothful servant. I gave you something. You did nothing with it. You catching that whole thing? I come back to this teaching all the time because I just think it's really good teaching to get us all kind of involved in the body of Christ, because I'm this pastor that refuses to think that the pastor's got to be everything to the body of Christ. I'm just a dude that does my gift every Sunday, you know what I mean? And tries my best with the heart God gave me to serve during the week. I mean, you get that whole thing? But I'm no different than you. I don't put myself on a pedestal above or below. That's crazy. You don't see no king chairs here on our platform, do you? There's a king chair back there in the back. You all see that when you go to the bathroom? That wasn't made for me. That was made for King Herod in the play. You get that? But by golly, if God, Lord, gave me a gift, you know what I'm going to do with it? I'm going to do the best I can possibly do with it. There's things my father gave me. You know how I cherish the things my father gave me? My father's dead. My father's gone. You know how much I value the things that were given to me by my earthly father? They're of great value to me because that's all I still have to remember him above. You know what? It's just, and what the Lord gives, how do you say this? God's gift to me is what he made me. My gift to him is what I do with it. Does everybody get that? My gift to God is to surrender myself back to Him, be useful for His service. If I put Him first, all these other things will fall together, they'll just work in my life. If I put the Lord first, it'll just work. I don't have to go chase worldly things. I just need to operate in the things God called me to walk in. If I operate in those things, it'll be okay. He who gives with liberality. If you're a person that just gives, listen, most givers don't want anybody to know they give. That makes sense? They just give. They see themselves like a funnel. You understand that? They realize that God gives to me so I can give. And they have this understanding that the more I give, the more God will give me increase. And the more God gives me increase, the more I can give. That makes sense? And they've got past this whole thing where I can't outgive God. And often you'll hear a giver say, you can't outgive God, because you can't. Because they have tried in their life to just give and give. They've given till it hurts so many times and realized, oh, every time I empty myself, God gives me more. There's something about a giver that just understands those principles, and they're not afraid to give, because there are people in this place right now that are afraid to give because you're like, I don't know if I'm going to have more. Givers don't have that at all. They just know God brought them this far. God will take them on. And you hear me? And they just give. They love to give. They love to help. Those people, I just want to tell you, they're among us right now. Those people cause things to happen in the kingdom of God, and nobody even knows who gave. Nobody knows who. You get that? I don't know if you understand around here related to giving. The men that are in charge of the money around here, they're pretty tight. They're squeaky tight. You know what I mean? That's a joke. We don't waste a lot of money around here. We say we don't waste any money around here. You don't see chandeliers hanging. We're not trying to be fancy. We're trying to be comfortable. Hey, we got those chairs out of Urbana's auditorium. They work, don't they? We didn't even go buy chairs. We tried to just get by on what, you know, makes us somewhat comfortable and get some lights and get some heat and get some, you know, and do the best we can. You know what I mean? So we had put a lot of value on the ministry that's outside of our building, what we're trying to do, missionaries, all kinds, you know what I'm saying? So we try to take that and put it in. And now we try to go to the places where we have missionaries, so we're very connected to the places we're sending money. I mean, you get me? And I'm not saying that, but to say, if people give, this church is really wonderful about doing the right thing with that. Better than any church I've ever seen. But there are givers in the body. They just love to give. They'll give whatever. They'll give a blanket. They'll give this. Whatever the need is, they'll just give. They'll just give. They'll just give. They'll just give. Give, 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 give. If you're a giver, give, right? The next one here, he who leads with diligence. I just love this picture. Joy did a great job, this picture. Can you see that? I don't even have notes up here. Why don't you have this? I don't know why I have this. You see that picture? Leaders rule their own life very well, very organized people, have a plan, see the big picture. Able to delegate well, able to understand what needs to get done, aren't bogged down by things that don't matter. And really, those people ought to be very important in the body of Christ for leading things. That makes sense? God gave you a leadership ability. A lot of people that have a leadership ability, they are using it out there to do pretty well in life. I'd love for leaders to recognize God gave them that leadership ability to be used in church, to really lead and to help. There's a lady in our first service. I mentioned it there, so I'm not telling on her. The lady by the name of Lisa Blake, that girl's most ordinary. She's got all the way every weekend through like July already planned. You know what I mean? She comes on and helps in our church. It's an amazing thing. When you bring a leader into a church to help organize and lead things, it's very powerful. He who shows mercy with cheerfulness. So the last gifting is mercy. A mercy person, somebody who cares about somebody that's emotional or hurting. We got a lot of mercy people in our church. You understand that? If somebody's crying, you'll run to somebody crying. I'm somebody, when somebody's crying, I'll just stay back, you know. But there's people in this church, somebody's crying, they'll just run to them. Oh, if you say, oh, a lot. I've found a lot of mercy people love animals. I married a mercy person. I did. I get it. She cares about hurting people. She's always for the underdog. That's why she's a Browns fan. Who's the worst team? I'll root for them. They're always getting beat up. Oh, my poor team. You get that whole thing? There's a whole bunch of mercy people. You want to hear? Just talk to mercy people real quick. You are the most wonderful, good-hearted, beautiful, loving people, genuine people. Help people in their time of need. But don't help people forever. Learn how to move on to the next hurting person, because you'll begin to enable people. Cut people off at some point, don't baby them forever. Hear that? Because you'll get used. Now, let's go back. Betty's back there now. Betty, I didn't know if that was you. I'd have picked on you more. Go back to that list here. Bounce back 7 slides for me, would you? Yeah. Things you're born with, according to the Scripture. Prophecy, serving, teaching, exhortation, giving, leadership, and mercy. You were born with one of those. Supposed to use it for the body of Christ. You use it out there in life all the time. And you know, most of the time, just by the description I gave you, you probably figured out who you were. Right? You're also married to or have people of different motivational gifts sitting around you. Now, hopefully, you have a little bit more understanding why they're so weird. Why they're so different than you, right? And people, now this is so funny, but people often marry somebody very opposite of them. You all get that whole thing? Because they know what they're strong in and they know what they're weak in, and they're looking for somebody that's strong in a different... Yet some people marry opposites, and guess what happens when they get married? They're so very different, they start fighting over everything. You get that? So you forget. The same thing happens in the body of Christ if you're not careful. People are very different than those of the people you don't like. No, God created them to be for a different job in the body of Christ. Love them because they're doing something you don't do. You don't do well. Everybody get that? The second list of gifts given from God is from Jesus the Son. Let's pop down to that list, okay? It's the next listing, I think, Betty. Right there. Ephesians 4, and he gave some, he himself gave, who's he himself? Jesus. Jesus, the head of the church. So what's the Lord's going to give gifts to the church. The Lord Jesus is going to give gifts to the church. He's the head of the church. So he calls people to minister to the body of Christ. Everybody get that whole thing? And he calls these 5 different offices. Believe it or not, as a pastor, I'm a gift to the body of Christ. God called me to be... I'd like to just put a bow on my head up here. God called me, hey, to be a gift to you. To speak things, to encourage, to help. And there's 5 different types of offices or those types of gifting that Jesus gives. I can list them real quick. They're apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. Real quick on apostles, real fast on apostles. This is my opinion. Apostles are older men that are pastors. That makes sense? Very wise, been around a long time, understand the Word of God, understand church issues, understand how working with people. Very deep in things. That makes sense? I'll give you, for instance, God uses me a pastor. I'm a pastor. That makes sense? Look in the dictionary under pastor, you're going to see me. Okay? I'm the definition of pastor. Okay? But in Peru, there are churches there where we've installed pastors and built buildings and those kind of things. Those pastors still call me and talk to me. When I go, they come, pastor or apostle and preach in our church. They see me as something more than a pastor because I've built their buildings and oversaw and installed the pastors, give some support to the pastors to help them. You know that makes sense? So when I go to Peru sometimes, they see me more of an apostle, brother, speak into my life. Now, I don't think that's the job God called me to, but I operated a little bit in some areas apostolically because I'm speaking into the lives of pastors, into churches, have a vision for a church. There's apostles in the body of Christ. There were early apostles. The Bible doesn't teach anywhere that those things went away. Still apostles in the body of Christ. Prophets. Now we saw prophecy in the last list. We see office of a prophet. These are people that just speak what God says. Again, they're a little bit scary. Prophets, prophecy and prophets have trouble making friends. They're a little bit strange sometimes. You see somebody really strange in the body of Christ, you might say, well, that's a prophet. That's a joke, by the way. People are just concerned about, this is what the Lord says. That's how they speak. Everybody get that? I can go up in my desk drawer right now in my office and read to you what prophets have spoken over my life. When I was young, they spoke things like, you're going to pastor a church someday. The prophet spoke, now get this, a prophet said, the Lord is going to plant you on the side of a hill. He's going to drive you like a stake in the ground. And you're going to fight against spiritual strongholds in a community. The Lord's going to establish a church through you on the side of a hill. And he'll drive you so deep, nobody will be able to pull you out. Years ago, one prophet prophesied over me. He said, I see you in a clown costume. I see you doing a ministry where you'll love to laugh. I see you, the Lord using you with humor. And I see the Lord using you to make people happy. God will use you and there'll be much humor in the ministry you do with people. It'll be different than what you see in other pastors or your whole, you'll just be different. God will use you to make people laugh. And I could go, these are things said about me from prophets years ago. Last prophetic word spoken in my life, I was in a real broken time in my life, and somebody came to me and said, Mark, you are the Lord's beloved son. He loves you. He loves you, and he's with you. And he will use your heart to speak to many. When I was at that funeral the other day, I think I told you that story a week or so ago. Lady said, shut up. And she said, the Lord's going to use you. The Lord's going to use your heart to speak to people. And as soon as she said that, I remembered that other prophetic thing that the Lord already spoke to me. Prophet. Evangelist. Here's the most famous evangelist. Billy Graham, right? You know what evangelists do? Today's the day of salvation. Hey, everybody bow your heads. We're going to count to 10. You're going to come to the altar right now. Come now. You know, right now we're going to get saved. You got to turn or burn. You know what I mean? Right now is the day of salvation. You better repent of your sin. You're convicted because you didn't take the dog out enough times yesterday. Evangelists will somehow they'll get it cranked around where they got you in a headlock and you better get straightened up with the Lord and you better come now. Very exciting, very moving, very compelling, you know what I mean? But they want people to repent and change. Pastors, the next one on there. What are pastors? Listen, you don't have to do anything today. Pastors are like shepherds. They just consistently care for a flock. They love and they teach and they take them to the good water and they take them to the green grass and they try to keep them together. They know them by name. Teachers. We kind of touched teachers before, but people that have an office of a teacher are just recognizing the church for being these teachers. Now, I did this on a for a reason today. We're out of time this morning. But the last set of giftings are gifts we get from the Holy Spirit. Can I show them to you real quick just so you can see them? I'm going to teach on them next week. You got them right here, Betty? Hello? Yeah. Wake up. There. Look at these gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Look at these. These are little weird ones. Word of knowledge, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, miracles, prophecy, discerning spirit, tongues, interpretation of tongues. Do we believe in those things? Absolutely. They're gifts you get from the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm going to pick up on the teaching of that next week. Next Sunday night, we begin a class. We call it the Holy Spirit class, where we begin to seek God for these gifts. God, gifts from the Father, you get from birth. Gifts from Jesus, He just gives to the body of Christ. These gifts you get because you seek God for them. These are supernatural gifts. And I'll tell you some stories next week about these giftings, okay? And how they work in the body of Christ and what I've seen good and what I've seen bad. All right? And we'll pick that up next Sunday, all right? Father, thanks for time together today and for reminding us again there's all kinds of gifts you give that we might be deep in the Lord, that we might experience what the Father, what the Son and the Holy Spirit has for us. I pray, Lord Jesus, that today we just spur that thinking again, that we have something from God that we can use for God. And compel us, Lord, to begin to think about those things and be active in them. So, Lord, thank you. You didn't leave any of us out. We weren't created to be trash. We were created of great value to be used to bless our brothers and sisters in the church. And I pray, Lord Jesus, we have an awakening to all those things. We thank you for this time together. Pray, God, you go with each one, even through their drive today, Lord, and the weather that's coming. I pray your hand be upon